What's up, cheeseheads? Welcome back. You know the drill. My name's Paul Brettel. I'm the site editor over at Dairyland Express, where we cover the Packers, Brewers, your 2020-21 NBA champions, Milwaukee Bucks, For the Culture, Bucks and Six, and the Wisconsin Badgers. Crown them. I also have a new article out every Monday and Friday over at Cheesehead TV. And joining me today is my good friend, Jacob Westendorf, the president, founder, owner, captain of Game On Wisconsin. So first, Jacob, how the heck are you doing? And two, tell these fine folks where they can find you as well as Game On Wisconsin.
Yeah, that was pretty good, first of all. So thank you. I didn't even pay you to say all that stuff. So I must be doing all right. But yeah, you can find me on Twitter. I'm at Jacob Westendorf. The Pick Six podcast airs every Wednesday. So our first episode came out today. We recorded in the middle of Game Six of Bucks and Suns. So that was interesting, trying to pay attention to both things. And then Game On Wisconsin, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube. Follow us, subscribe on our YouTube page, and hit that little bell in the top right corner so you never miss anything that we do. That's where you can find all of our stuff. It's some really cool things in the pipeline that I can't tell you about just yet, but I can tell you that you're not going to want to miss season two.
Absolutely. Great content, great Packers info, great people. Win, win, win. So today I asked Jacob to join me because I came out with my pre-training camp superlatives article. This is something that I do probably a couple times throughout the year. I'll do one halfway through the season, at the end of the season, before the draft, just picking out some superlatives, some buzzwords, I guess you could say, and associating a player with them. So I thought it'd be just a good conversation for us to have. So let's kick things off with do not forget about. So do not forget about this player in training camp and as the preseason and regular season begins. So Jacob, take away, who's on your radar for don't forget about?
The most talented tight end on the roster, everybody's breakout player from 2020 that didn't quite come to fruition, and he's got a two-game suspension coming up when the season starts, but that is Jace Sternberger. I am still in on the Sternberger train. He just hasn't had any good luck or anything go his way since he became a professional football player. He's been injured. Last year he had COVID during camp, and then they thought he might have had COVID again towards the end of the season. Just kind of an up-and-down struggle all year long. He started to do a few good things by the middle of the year, struggled with some drops, but that's just not really part of his game as things go forward. And I think the Packers really do, and Matt LaFleur has the ability to feature him and Robert Tonyan while still utilizing guys like Josiah DeGuara, Dominique Daphne, and Mercedes Lewis, obviously, in the run game. But I'm in on Sternberger. I think he's, like I said, the most talented tight end that the Packers have and the biggest ability to create a matchup problem, which are the words Brian Gutekunst used to describe him just a year ago.
Yeah, good pick. And I'm actually staying at that same position regroup, going with Josiah DeGuara. We saw very little of him last year because he did tear his ACL, but I'm really excited to see a full season of him in the Matt LaFleur offense, how he's utilized and really how LaFleur develops his utilization over the course of the season. We got a glimpse of what he can offer this offense in week one against Minnesota. I really think that was it. It was one game. I think he was on the field for 24, 25 snaps, something like that. But it was a perfect microcosm of what he can do. The versatility lined up out of the backfield, in line, as well as in the slot. He had a couple key blocks. And as Ben Fennell noted during that game or after that game, there were a couple designed plays for him. If you go back and look at the stat sheet, that never panned out. But you could tell that LaFleur wanted to get him involved. So he plays into that illusion of complexity that LaFleur often discusses, keeping defenses off balance. So I really am excited to see what he can do in this offense. And for as good as this offense was last year, I think he is someone that might have been forgotten about, lost in the shuffle because he was injured. Moving along. Oh, go on.
Oh, I was going to say, yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, the highlight play, if you was the block on the Allen Lazard end around where he took out two guys on one play. So I look forward to seeing, this is a guy they drafted for that role specifically in this offense. And I think you've seen when they've had specific plans for certain rookies, Elgton Jenkins, AJ Dillon, they've flourished. So I look forward to seeing that too.
Yeah, very well said. Next up, we'll move on to our most intriguing player. I'll kick us off for this one. So for me, he's someone that I have written about before, Devin Funchess, because I feel like the spectrum on where he could land this season is incredibly wide. I could see him becoming an impact player on third downs and in the red zone with that 6'4", 225 frame lining up in the slot. he's a mismatch waiting to happen against those slot corners and linebackers. However, on the flip side, I could also see him being cut as well. For starters, the Packers save, I believe it's $1.3 million cap space, and they do still need to create cap space, by the way. But he hasn't played in two seasons. Week one will have been about 2 years. It was 2018 since his last full season. How quickly does he shake off the rust? How quickly does he pick up the Matt LaFleur offense? How does he gel with quarterback one when he returns? So I think there's a lot of question marks there. And one thing I always note as well is he hasn't been, not saying he can't, but up until this point in his career, he hasn't been a special teams contributor. So when you're talking about back end of the roster players, that oftentimes comes into play. So like I said, I could see him being an impact player this season. I could see him being cut as well. So I am very interested to see where he ends up throughout training camp and preseason. Jacob?
Jordan Love. And I know that you mentioned a wide range of where somebody could end up.
Very true.
Isn't that Jordan Love? He could be the starter on a team that has a Super Bowl-ready roster. He could be a backup that you hope never plays, and he could be the starter, the heir apparent. He could be a trade piece. We really just don't know. The Aaron Rodgers situation has thrown a wrench into everything this Packers team has planned, including Jordan Love. But let's go through it. Jordan Love is a first-round pick. The Packers love his talent. His arm talent, there's no denying that. It's the inconsistency, the ups and downs that are the question mark. The upside, if he hits, he's Patrick Mahomes. If he doesn't hit and busts, he's like Ryan Leaf, Kyle Bowler, name somebody like that. That's not a good situation for those of you that maybe are too young to remember if those guys were playing. Not some very good football throughout that course of time. But Jordan Love, to me, we didn't see him at all last year. Was third-string quarterback, never dressed. There was no preseason. Camp was camp. That is what it is. He took basically every rep during the spring and summer sessions, during the OTA sessions. I think that the Packers are going to do that at camp, even if Aaron Rodgers is back. And I do anticipate Aaron Rodgers will be back at some point during camp, if not right away. I do anticipate him being here next Tuesday, but that's a different discussion. Jordan Love, to me, how good does he look in camp? Is he trade bait? Is he the starter next season? Is he the starter this season? What does it all mean? Where does it all go? I think quarterback 1-0 is the guy you want to pay attention to in camp.
Yeah, that's a great pick. I had Jordan Love in my as my most excited to see because, I mean, we didn't get to see him last year. Their fans weren't allowed at training camp. There were some clips put out by the reporters that were allowed there. No preseason. Obviously didn't suit up during the regular season. I just want to see him in action, really, regardless of what takes place. So next up, let's move on to our Rookie of the Year. So, Jacob, I'll let you kick this one off.
I think it's going to be their first-round pick. I think Eric Stokes is in line to get some snaps with the first team. And even if he doesn't right away, I think he's somebody that could overtake Kevin King somewhat early in the season, very similar to the way Jaire Alexander did with, say, Devon House. When he came, I'm not comparing those two players, two different styles, but the talent of Stokes is evident. The speed is there. And he's somebody I think that the Packers maybe want to aim higher than good enough, average, whatever with Kevin King. And the other reality is Kevin King's injury history is not something that's very positive for him. So Stokes is going to have an opportunity, whether he starts week one or not. And I think he's as close to ready to play as most rookies can be. He'll go through some growing pains, but I think you're going to get plenty of opportunities. Opportunities mean chances to get your hands on the ball. That could mean a few interceptions, some splash plays for the defensive side of the ball. So give me the first round pick.
So for me, I'm going one round later. I'm going with Josh Myers. So with all these rookies, we got to see how training camp, how the preseason unfolds. But the talk right now is that he is going to be the week one starter, based on what they've seen so far and what expectations are. Obviously all of that can change. So I think he is my pick for Rookie of the Year. Reason being, because I think he's going to see the most snaps out of the rookies compared to Amari Rodgers and Eric Stokes. I also think he's set up well for success. Yeah, he's going to be a rookie, but he comes from a big school. He's well equipped to handle Matt LaFleur's outside zone run scheme. As a pass blocker, he gets to the second level quite well. But also I think he's set up well for success because if the tackles are David Bakhtiari and Billy Turner, which we expect, that means the guards likely are Elgton Jenkins and Lucas Patrick. So I think having guys of that caliber, and Lucas Patrick really flew under the radar last year with how just, you know, wasn't great by any means, but he was rock solid. So I think having those veterans next to him will set him up for success. I think overall, this is going to be, once again, a very, very good Green Bay Packers offensive line unit. And so for those reasons, along with, like I said, I think he's just going to see the most snaps out of the other rookies, just because that's really the nature of the position compared to the cornerback. If you're not, you know, quarterback one, cornerback two, which Stokes may become, and then Amari Rodgers in that wide receiver four gadget slot role. So for those reasons, I think he's going to end up being the rookie that at the end of the year we look back on and impress the most. So let's knock out one more of these with our X factor. For me, I'm sticking with the offensive line, going with Billy Turner. It was a bumpy, we'll call it bumpy, 2019 season for him at right guard. Transitions to right tackle last season and played really, really well. Took, I think it was over 300 snaps there, another 300 at left tackle, 400 or something in that range at right guard. He was versatile and really wherever they put him, I know he struggled in the NFC Championship game, but for the most part, wherever they put him, he was reliable, steady, and was a big part of the Packers' success last year. That offensive line unit, we don't see what they did. We don't see guys getting injured, players being shuffled around, and week in, week out, this unit still playing at a high level. By sacks allowed, pressures allowed, ESPN's metrics, this was the best offensive line unit in football last year. And I think Turner played a huge part in that. So as we look ahead to this season, again, they're going to need to have him continue playing at a high level. And if he does, again, like I alluded to in talking about Myers, I think this can be a very, very good offensive line unit. And when you have a very, very good offensive line unit, that allows the rest of the offense to be successful as well. This isn't the top scoring offense, the top offense by DVOA last season without that offensive line playing at that level. So for me, my X factor, Billy Turner. How about you, Jacob?
What a bummer that the Packers just haven't done anything to surround Aaron Rodgers with any talent.
That's unfortunate.
Whatsoever. Just a bummer that they haven't had the best offensive line in football. Yeah, you're right. Last season, my X factor, you're going to go with the big uglies, and that's fine. I love offensive line play, former lineman myself. I am going to go something with a little more sex appeal, for lack of better phrasing, and that's Amari Rodgers. I think that I know he's a rookie, but I talked about players that have designed roles for them, and I think Amari could be somebody that has that immediately, that could use him in that Tyler Irvin role. I think if you guys want an example of a game to watch last year, just replace everything they did with Tyler Irvin against Minnesota in week one last year and San Francisco on that Thursday night game in November. I think if you plug Amari Rodgers into those slots and then add in the fact that a not terrible return game can cover up a lot of stink on special teams. And I think Amari Rodgers is going to be your opening day kickoff and punt returner. And the Packers, let's be honest, guys, when Tyler Irvin joined the team, and he did well. I'm not trying to knock Tyler Irvin here, but I think we all thought he was better than what he was just because he wasn't god-awful like all of the other return men that they were throwing back there. I mean, with all due respect to Malik Taylor, kickoff return man is not something he should be doing. Amari Rodgers is experienced at it. He's good at it. He has that vision and explosive nature. He alone can make this special teams unit not a complete tire fire like it was in 2020-2021. It was awful. And I think that'll make the new special teams coordinator that they brought in, I think he'll look better as a result of that. And the offense, RPO actions, jet sweeps, again, with all due respect to some of the guys that were getting those handoffs, Alan Lazard, Tyler Irvin, just Jamal Williams even, not the explosive athlete that Amari Rodgers is. And add in, he's their first top 100 pick at wide receiver since Davante Adams. So that's not nothing either. I think the Packers certainly have some opportunities to find some spots for him, and he can make their offense even better in 2021 than it was in 2020, which is crazy to think.
That is, and you took the words right out of my mouth there, because Amari Rodgers, what he brings to this Matt LaFleur offense, I mean, they haven't had that. They haven't had a true slot receiver. They haven't had that explosive gadget player. We know Irvin was supposed to fill that role, but he was injured. But it's a credit to Matt LaFleur and the rest of this offense because he filled in those guys. And it kind of along the same lines with Josiah DeGuara filling that H-back role. I know in a way Dominic Daphne kind of did that at the end of last season, but
not the same, though.
Exactly. If we're looking at potential, what they can offer, Josiah DeGuara is on a different level. So if you're adding those two elements to this offense that are both key to what LaFleur does, but also two pieces that he hasn't really had, or at least not had consistently or at this level. It's you hit it on the head. It's correct. This can be a much more scarier offense with those two on the field and just throughout the regular season.
Yeah. I think the other thing that we didn't even mention, and I'm going to cheat a little bit here, is, again, love Jamal Williams, but AJ Dillon, explosive athlete. And you guys saw what he could do. That Titans game from last year is phenomenal. Watch the Rams game in the playoffs last year, the way they used Dillon and Jones throughout the course of that game. There are ways it's weird that the Packers offense could be better than it was last year. And last year it was the best offensive football.
Absolutely. Well said. So that'll do it for this episode, guys. Jacob, I very much appreciate you joining me. You can find the rest of my superlatives over at Dairyland Express. As always, I went overboard, and I think I have like 10 or 11 on there. And then you can find me on Twitter at @Paul_Brettel. All of my work at Dairyland Express and Cheesehead TV. Jacob, one more time, where can the good folks find you?
I just counted, and it is 10. You can find me on Twitter at Jacob Westendorf. You can find some writing at Game On Wisconsin, GameOnWI.com. And I do an article a week for Packer Report. I'm going to pick that up again starting next week. I took a little sabbatical, if you will, kind of like a certain quarterback or something might have done for a little period of time. But follow us, like I mentioned, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, Game On Wisconsin or Game On WI, depending on the platform. And of course, wherever you find podcasts on your favorite smartphone device, go ahead and shoot a follow over to Game On Wisconsin on there.
Jacob Westendorf, Aaron Rodgers, you heard it here, one of the same. As always, thank you guys for tuning in. I appreciate you. I'll be back with another video not too long from now. Until then, take care, stay safe, and as always, go Pack, go.